Friday, February 28. Below is a chart summarising what we've looked at so far regarding the sequence of kingdoms depicted in Daniel 2, 7 and 8. What does this tell us about the cleansing of the sanctuary? And there's a table here with three columns for Daniel 2, next to Daniel 7, next to Daniel 8. For Daniel 2 and 7, the first line has Babylon. For Daniel 2 and 7 and 8, we have Medo-Persia in all three. And then for the next one, Greece in all three. Then for the next line, pagan Rome in all three. And then the next line, papal Rome in all three. For Daniel 2, the next line has nothing there, but in Daniel 7, there's judgment in heaven. Daniel 8, there's cleansing of the sanctuary. And the last line for Daniel 2 has the second coming, and for Daniel 7 has the second coming. As we can see here, there are parallels between the chapters. Not only are the nations depicted in parallel to each other, the judgment seen in Daniel 7, which arises after the 1260 years, that's AD 538 to 1798 of Papal Rome, directly parallels the cleansing of the sanctuary, which in Daniel 8 arises after Rome as well. In short, this heavenly judgment in Daniel 7, the judgment that leads to the end of the world, is the same thing as the cleansing of the sanctuary in Daniel 8. We are given here two different depictions of the same thing, and both occur after the 1260-year period of persecution perpetrated by the Little Horn Power. And that brings us to our two discussion questions for this week. One, how does the chart above show us that the cleansing of the sanctuary, the same thing as the judgment in Daniel 7, must occur sometime after the 1260-year prophecy of the Little Horn, and yet before the establishing of God's final kingdom? 2. The prophecy of Daniel 8 depicts history as something violent and full of evil. The two animals, symbolizing two world empires, fight each other, as we read in Daniel 8, verses 8 to 12. Therefore the male goat grew very great, but when he became strong, the large horn was broken, and in place of it four notable ones came up toward the four winds of heaven. And out of one of them came a little horn which grew exceedingly great toward the south, toward the east, and toward the glorious land. And it grew up to the host of heaven, and it cast down some of the host and some of the stars to the ground and trampled them. He even exalted himself as high as the prince of the host, and by him the daily sacrifices were taken away, and the place of his sanctuary was cast down. Because of transgression, an army was given over to the horn to oppose the daily sacrifices, and he cast truth down to the ground. He did all this and prospered. The little horn power that arises after them is a violent and persecuting power. We read this in Daniel 8, 23 to 25, and in the latter time of their kingdom, when the transgressors have reached their fullness, a king shall arise, having fierce features, who understands sinister schemes. His power shall be mighty, but not by his own power. He shall destroy fearfully, and shall prosper and thrive. He shall destroy the mighty, and also the holy people. Through his cunning he shall cause deceit to prosper under his rule, and he shall exalt himself in his heart. He shall destroy many in their prosperity. He shall even rise against the prince of princes, but he shall be broken without human means. Thus, Scripture here makes no attempt to downplay the reality of suffering in this world. How should this help us learn to trust in God and his goodness, despite the reality of evil we see all around us? Inside Story. Our mission story this week is titled Testimony from the Tomb, and it's written by Andrew McChesney of Adventist Mission. George Cobb is the man who died twice. Little is known about Cobb, and no photos of him are known to exist, but his grave has attracted attention for decades because of his tombstone in a cemetery in Brunswick in the United States, state of Maine, bears a birth date and two death dates. It reads, Born June 10, 1794, died November 10, 1848, fell asleep May 9, 1882. In fact, Cobb was baptized on November 10, 1848, and he asked that the date of his conversion be carved on his tombstone after he was laid to rest in the grave on May 9, 1882, at the age of 88. This is one of the interesting examples, again, of the faith and willingness and the determination of our pioneers to share their faith in whatever means possible, including having something engraved on your tombstone that will share your faith after you have fallen asleep, says James Nix, director of the Ellen G. White Estate. The tombstone includes text from the Fourth Commandment, "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy." Nix has sought to find a photograph of Cobb and to track down his descendants, but without success. "I have looked high and low for a picture of Cobb," he said. "I have asked up here, are there descendants of Cobb? I would like to know about this man who cared that much to leave instructions and money to carve all that extra text on his tombstone." Cobb's unique witness from the grave has touched the hearts of many people, including church members who have stopped by the cemetery. "He recognized that he needed to die to self, and then he truly could become alive," said 10 N.C. Wilson, president of the worldwide Seventh-day Adventist Church. "So he lived his life in a beautiful demonstration of the contrast between living a life for himself and dying to the old self and becoming a new creature in Christ. What a privilege to see his tombstone." Karen Glassford, a third-generation Adventist missionary who works as Education and Communication Coordinator at the Church's Institute of World Mission, said that when she initially saw the tombstone, she suspected that the first death date might refer to Cobb's baptism. "His tombstone has become such a witness to other people," she said. "It has made them curious. Why did he die twice? I'm sure there will be people in heaven because of that man's tombstone." This lesson was read by Dr. Percy Harold for Christian Services for the Blind and Hearing Impaired, Christian Record Services for the Blind, the Sabbath School Department, and Hope Channel. You can also listen on the official Sabbath School 4 app and the Apple iTunes app, Sabbath School with Percy Harold. Remember, God is always faithful.